Good morning, church.
Good morning.
What a blessing to gather with you. I pray that everybody is gathering in good spirits and good health. Welcome to everybody who's joining us in person and on Zoom or Facebook Live. And I pray that I woke up this morning and looked at my phone and I saw that there was a flood alert or advisory or something like that, specifically for Montgomery County. So I pray that nobody's house floated away and that everybody and their family are safe and their property and everything like that. We come this morning to gather on the fourth Sunday after the Epiphany. And so I pray that this morning we might continue to feel the light of God illuminating our worship and illuminating our lives. And also, just a quick note, after the worship today, immediately after, we have our congregational meeting. And that means that's going to take place right after the worship ends. So when the benediction is over, if you are so able, remain in your seats. Or if you need to use the restroom, go and do that and come back so that we can get our congregational meeting going. And there's a scene from who remembers the movie The Lion King? They're going to the watering hole at the beginning, and the little parrot, Zazu says, "Step lightly. The sooner we get to the watering hole, the sooner we can leave." So with that spirit, I encourage you to approach the congregational meeting at the end of worship. I'm just kidding, John. Let us pray. Loving God, we invoke your presence in your name this morning. We ask your blessings upon this worship, and that through us we may lift up a joyful noise to you and further your kingdom through our worship today and all that we do. In your loving name we pray. Amen.
Please rise in body and spirit if you feel comfortable, and join responsibly in the call to worship. Hallelujah.
We give thanks to God with all our heart.
The works of God are great and wonderful in our eyes.
We delight in God's works of healing and transformation.
God's healing is holistic, encompassing body, mind, and spirit.
God's covenant is a blessing.
God's precepts are righteous and just.
We worship God through our acts of service.
Let us worship God.
Amen.
Thank you.
Please join in the invocation prayer.
Scripture tells us that love binds everything together. It is how we are held. It is how we exist at all. Let us reawaken ourselves to love's presence in our lives and in our community. May our worship not be a rote emotion, but rather an experience of love poured out for all those scattered here. Open in us what love is required of us today, O God, and in your heart may we find peace.
Please join me in this time of prayer and meditation where we confess our sins and remind ourselves of the transformation that is available to all of us and the new life in God. Gracious and merciful God, you who are faithful and just, at this time we examine our lives, hold up our lives to you in the light of your righteousness, which endures forever. Through your covenant made in love, O God, you have given us commandments, you raise prophets from among us, you speak to us and you ask us to become accountable. Yet often we ignore your ways and disdain your works. We close ourselves to your prophets and to the suffering in our world. Forgive us, renew us, O God, that we may walk in faithfulness to you today, tomorrow, and all days. Amen. Friends, the good news is that God's love, God's righteousness, God's mercy endures forever. And God's covenant of love is always with us, is always at hand. The promises of God's covenant of grace assure us that this day and all days, we have the opportunity, the ability to set aside our old ways and turn back to God. So this day, let us witness to God's righteousness through acts of love and mercy. Let us walk in renewed faithfulness in the light of the call of God. For God so loved the world that God gave God's only Son so that all who believeth in him may not perish, but have eternal life. Receive, my siblings in Christ, the full measure of God's pardon, mercy, and love. Amen.
Come on and go.
Do I have any children and youth who would like to come forward at this time? All right, good to see you. Ven, Manu, ven. Do you want to hold this? Thanks. Come forward. If you wish, you may also stay where you are. Hi, Sydney. Have a seat, have a seat. Thank you, thank you. I think that's good. Thank you so much. Make a little semicircle, if you will. Less people, okay. Well, you can still do a semicircle. Uh-huh. Okay. Good morning. Good morning. Good morning. Ooh. Let's start like we always start with. ¿Qué pasó? ¿Quieres sentarte acá?
No.
Okay. Let's start like we always start with our little fingers, right? No? This one?
No.
Which one? Our thumbs, right? Our thumbs, right, Manu? We put our thumb up if we're doing great. We put our thumb down if we're doing bad. We put our thumb somewhere in the middle if we're doing somewhere in the middle. Ready? One, two, three, ha. I love that we have thumbs all over the place. I'm going to share honestly with you. My thumb is in the middle because for some reason or other, I'm really hungry this morning. I had a full breakfast. And then Miss Donna gave me a little piece of the coffee cake that's going to be had later in the fellowship hour. And still, I feel really hungry, so I'm just somewhere in the middle. And it's just remember that however you are doing in church, most of all, God is delighted that you're here. And God is delighted that God is happy to see you wherever you, however you're doing, good, bad, or somewhere in the middle. All right, so I always start by asking a question, right? So my question is, I'm going to go around and ask everybody to think really hard about this. What is something you're really good at? What is something you are really, really good at? And don't tell me there's not something because there's everybody's really good at something. What's something you're really good at? Drawing. All right. I'd love to see a drawing that you do sometime. How about you, Emily? What's something you're really good at? Volleyball. Yeah, you play on a team, right? All right. Emily's good at volleyball. How about you? What's something you're really good at?
Drawing.
Lots of artists in this congregation, huh? Drawing? All right. How about you? What's something you're really good at?
Swimming.
Okay, swimming. And how about you? Drawing also? How about you, Manu? ¿Hay algo que tú haces muy bien? ¿Qué haces muy bien? He's really good at Spanish. Hablas muy bien en español, ¿sí? Hablas muy bien en español. He's very good at Spanish. Nayeli is very good at being cute. All right, you're just in time. What's something you're really good at?
Math.
Math. What's something you're really good at? Wow, they're both really good at math. Okay. So, in real life, you guys spend, even though you're all really, really good at something, you spend a lot of your time. You're so good at something, I think, that you could teach it to somebody else, right? The measure of how, if you're really good at something, if you can teach it to somebody else. So could you teach someone else how to do some math problems? Yeah. Could you teach someone else how to hit the volleyball? Yeah. Could you teach someone else how to draw a picture? Probably, right? All the things that you're good at, you could probably teach somebody else how to do it. But a lot of times, because you're kids, someone else gets to be the teacher, right? You go to school, who's the teacher? Who's your teacher? Who's your teacher? Miss Myers. Go to school, Miss Myers gets to be the teacher. You come to church, do you stand up in the pulpit and teach about the Bible?
No.
No, right? Before you go to Sunday school, do you give the Sunday school lesson or does Miss Donna?
Miss Donna.
Miss Donna. So many times in your lives, you don't get to be the teacher. But Jesus, who didn't have a teacher's degree, he was a young guy. He wasn't ordained like me, right? He didn't get to wear collars and robes and things. He walked into a temple. He'd never been in a temple teaching before. And he started to teach. It was the very beginning of his ministry, so nobody knew who he was. Nobody knew anything about him. Young 33-year-old guy. He walks into a temple, and he starts to teach. And the people say right away, this is one who teaches with authority. Who knows what authority is? What's authority?
Power.
What else is another word for authority? What other way to say authority? Power, authority. like he is an expert. Like he really knows what he's talking about. Even though he doesn't have a degree, he doesn't have a license, he's not the rabbi or the priest, right? He teaches with authority, like he's an expert. And the people get shocked, and the priests in the temple get really upset because they don't think that he should be doing that, but he teaches anyway. The moral of the story, the thing that I want you to remember, is there's always going to be something you're good at, and maybe even better than anybody else. It might be just that you're a really good friend, right? It might be that you're really good at eating. I'm really good at eating. No, I'm serious. I take it seriously. I love to eat. I'm very good at it. There's always going to be something that you're good at. So remember that Jesus wants you to remember that you can be an expert too. You can be an authority at the things that you're really good at. Can you remember that? Yeah? All right, let's pray. Your friend Ethan. What's going on with your friend Ethan?
For the first time in a few weeks, he said mommy and moved a little bit.
Has he been sick?
Yeah.
He's been sick, right?
He can't even move or even talk.
Right. He's in the hospital?
Yeah.
We're going to pray for Ethan. Okay, let's pray. Loving God, we pray for Ethan. We know he is your beloved child, O God. We pray for his healing. We pray for his family. And we pray for his friends. Let us also remember, O God, that we are experts. That we are really good at loving one another. Just like you have loved us. Amen. All right, everybody. There's Sunday school. You're going to follow Miss Donna. Walk, don't run. And the nursery is also open with Miss Maura at the end of the hall in front of you. Amen.
Today's reading is from Deuteronomy, which describes our relationship with God. Mount Horeb, mentioned in the text, is the mountain at which God gives Moses the Ten Commandments. And in this passage, Moses is calling the next generations to be faithful. Deuteronomy chapter 18, verses 15 through 20. The Lord your God will raise you up a prophet like me from among your people. You shall heed such a prophet. This is what you requested of the Lord your God at Horeb on the day of the assembly when you said, "Let me not hear again the voice of the Lord my God or see this great fire anymore, lest I die." And then the Lord replied to me, "They are right in what they have said. I will raise up for them a prophet like you from among their own people. I will put my words in the mouth of the prophet who shall speak to them everything that I command. Anyone who does not heed the words that the prophet shall speak in my name, I myself will hold accountable. But any prophet who presumes to speak my name, a word that I have not commanded the prophet to speak, or who speaks in the name of other gods, that prophet shall die." The word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
The Holy Gospel according to Mark chapter 1, verses 21 through 28. They went to Capernaum, and when the Sabbath came, he entered the synagogue and taught. They were astounded at his teaching, for he taught them as one having authority and not as the scribes. Just then there was in their synagogue a man with an unclean spirit. And he cried out, "What have you to do with us, Jesus of Nazareth? Have you come to destroy us? I know who you are, the Holy One of God." But Jesus rebuked him, saying, "Be quiet and come out of him." And the unclean spirit, convulsing him and crying with a loud voice, came out of him. They were all amazed, and they kept on asking one another, "What is this? A new teaching with authority. He commands even the unclean spirits, and they obey him." At once his fame began to spread throughout the surrounding region of Galilee. This is the word of God for the people of God. Please pray with me. O God, at this time, may the words of my mouth and the meditations of all of our hearts be acceptable to you, O God, our rock and our redeemer. Before I go any further, before I start, shall we say, I want to make a big deal out of the fact that we have Loretta Helton in service with us this morning. Miss Loretta, if you wouldn't mind standing up. Let's give her a round of applause. We love seeing you on Zoom, and we love seeing you here in person, so we're glad that you're here. The title for my sermon this morning is The Exorcism We Need. The Exorcism We Need. Ooh, I bet that made you feel a little nervous with that title, right? Don't worry, don't get too worried. I'm not going to call somebody forward and demand that the spirit leave them, the unclean spirit leave them. Or will I? In our text for this, who has seen the movie The Exorcist? Ray, show of hands. You know, it's funny that I have never seen that movie, but I used to do a lot of work down in Georgetown, and I used to pass, there's a staircase there where, yeah, I guess you all know, where they filmed the famous scene in that. I've never even seen the scene from it. But the reason I bring that up is that that's what we think about when we think exorcism, right? When you think exorcism, you think about a horror movie maybe, or you think about a church service or laying on of hands where we're trying to throw out a demon. Raise your hand if that's what you think about when you think exorcism, either supernatural or some intense church ritual. And even if we don't necessarily have that kind of belief or that kind of spirituality, you've got to admit that exorcism is a powerful term or a powerful concept within our culture. Look at how popular that movie is. It's clearly a cultural phenomenon or a cultural concept that has weight, no matter how we look at it. So what do? Jesus performs an exorcism. He casts out an unclean spirit in the temple. He does a lot of those in the Gospel of Mark, faith healings, casting out demons. What do we do with that in our scripture? What do we do with that concept in our culture? I think there's a large swath of the society, maybe even people in this congregation, who thinks that that is superstition, right? Superstitious. They don't really believe that that happens. I'm not saying that you think that way, but there are some people who do feel that way. And they might find that this story in the Bible reeks of a religiosity that to them is implausible at best or cultish at worst. I'm not saying I endorse that perspective, but I think there are some people that think that, and that's the reality. There are other people, many people out there in our society, for whom the concepts of angels and demons, spirits, the spirit world, are very real. As real as this lectern. And from their point of view, or that point of view, stories like this one are very important. And Jesus takes on the role of a healer, a crucial figure in our spiritual protection and our liberation. However we look at it, I think that arguing whether demons or angels exist or don't exist, are they supernatural, is that myth, or is it something else? I think it misses the point. I'm not going to take sides in that debate because I think the whole debate isn't the most important focus for our text this morning, for our faith. No matter what you believe about what actually happened on that day in that temple, my proposition to you is that there is an exorcism that needs to take place in our society today, and Jesus can still help us with it. Our text, as we've read, begins with Jesus striding into the temple in Capernaum. A commentator I was reading said it's like remember those saloon doors in those movies that swing back and forth, right? Like the doors that into a kitchen, bursting through them, right? Boom. He comes striding in, and Ched Myers, the commentator, writes, in one sentence, Mark moves Jesus from the symbolic margins to the heart of the provincial order. synagogue, sacred space, and Sabbath, sacred time. He goes from the outside right into the middle. Right away, people notice something different about Jesus. He teaches with authority, unlike that of the scribes. Immediately, he is challenged by a man possessed by an unclean spirit. The spirit questions Jesus, saying, "What have you to do with us?" And then he tries to dominate him by saying who he is. I think this is an interesting thing, right? Sometimes people try to call you out for who you are as a way to control you, get you to shut up, right? Has that ever happened to you? I know you. You're from there. I know your parents. I know who you really are. And it's not a complimentary thing. It's a way to get you to sit down and shut up, right? To threaten you, have control over you. That's what the unclean spirit does to Jesus. But Jesus will not be intimidated. He subdues the spirit and casts him out, and the people are left in consternation and confusion, astonished anew at this authority that Jesus commands. I confess that until just this week, I never really knew what to do with this story. I didn't know how to explain it. From a literary perspective, it doesn't make sense. Why would healing a person cause such consternation? It's not like today when those things are questioned. Back in Jesus' day, faith healing was widely accepted. That a man would come and heal somebody else would be no big deal. It happened all the time in that worldview. The Romans accepted it. The Jews accepted it. The Greeks accepted it. It wasn't a big deal. So why would people get so upset? What is it about Jesus' teaching that is so scandalous in the first place? What kind of authority does he have that is such a challenge to the other religious authorities? And the scribes don't say anything in this passage, but later on in chapter 3 of Mark, they do. When Jesus does another exorcism, they send a whole group of scribes from Jerusalem, scribes affiliated with Herod and with the central temple, to figure out what Jesus is doing. You can read it in Mark 3, 20 to 27. And they call him out over his ability to exorcise. They say he must be doing it by Satan, if you remember. It explodes into a major showdown, just like Jesus were there in a saloon with the scribes, both of them with their hands on their guns. Just like that. What is it about Jesus exercising the spirits that is such a threat to the scribal authority? It didn't make sense to me, never until now. And then I realized why they're so scared. And I realized that the reason the scribes and authorities feel so threatened by this exorcism is that the demon is a representation of them. The demon, I'll say that again, is a representation of them. In Binding the Commentary, Binding the Strong Man, a political reading of Mark's story of Jesus, Chad Myers contends that, quote, "The meaning of the powerful act must be found by viewing it in terms of symbolic reproduction of social conflict." I'll say that again because I feel like I'm in class again. The meaning of the powerful act must be found by viewing it in terms of symbolic reproduction of social conflict. The demon is a symbol for the entire scribal establishment that's oppressing the people. And Jesus is continually provoking them. They're always clashing. They're always at odds, right? So the exorcism represents the people's liberation. It's not just one person who's getting freed. It's everybody. Does that make sense? That makes sort of sense. That's why it was so controversial, not because he healed somebody, but because it was a symbolic representation of a greater conflict, of a social conflict. But the conflict goes even deeper than Jesus against the scribes. We always see Jesus going up against the scribes and the Pharisees, right? And then the Herodians, these Jewish religious authorities. The conflict goes beyond just Jesus and them, or the people and them. Later on, in the showdown I mentioned before, Jesus introduces the metaphor of the strong man. They say, You're casting out demons by Satan, they say to him. And he responds, you cannot enter, this is my paraphrasing, he says, you cannot enter a strong man's house and plunder it without first binding the strong man who guards it. Who's heard that before? To bind up the strong man. You haven't heard it because they don't like you to hear about Jesus saying those things. They don't put that in the lectionary because you don't like to they don't like you to hear about Jesus saying you've got to bind up the strong man. An exorcism is like a spirit possessing, like binding you, holding you. Jesus is saying there's a strong man out there. And we've got to bind him up. We've got to exorcise him from the body of the people, the collective body, politic, in order for us to be free. Who is the biggest strong man in Jesus' day? Was it a scribe in a provincial temple in Capernaum? Was it Herod in his palace in Jerusalem? Was he the strong man? I see one head nod. Who is the big strong man in Jesus' day? The Caesar, the empire, the whole system of empire that basically ran everything from afar. In other words, the really big bad demon that Jesus is trying to exorcise, to throw out, that undergirds the authority of the scribes and the Pharisees and even Herod and his armies, is the empire of Rome. And the strong man must be subdued in order to make way for the kingdom of God. You cannot plunder a man's house, Jesus says, without binding the strong man first in order to make way for the kingdom of God. I made this sound, this may sound like a lot, right? I kind of took us through a whole exegetical class there, and you don't have to agree with everything I said, but the point I think that we cannot deny is that Jesus is saying, there's some demonic forces at work in our world, and I will stand here from this pulpit and say, there are some demonic forces at work in our world today. I try not to be overly political. I'm not partisan. I don't particularly like any of the parties, if I am honest. But I think that Trumpism, Make America Great, this political movement that is so ascendant in our country, the way it holds sway, not only what over one political party, but a significant portion of the American populace, is a demonic power that has to be exercised from our social and political and cultural life. I've had friends, who knows what QAnon is. QAnon is a sort of conspiracy theory. It's basically a cult. Friends had family members get involved with QAnon, said they never were able to talk to them again. It's like they became part of a cult. Power, these cultural phenomena have power over our lives. But I told you I'm not partisan. I'll point the prophetic finger at the other side too. Look at the other side of the political aisle, where we have a president of the United States sending $14 billion in money and arms and political cover to a country that's actively committing a genocide. There's nothing more demonic than genocide. These are two examples of what I consider demonic forces that have a hold not just over our society, but that hold our whole world captive today, and they have to be exorcised. These unclean spirits of fascism. It is fascism, both here in the United States, in Argentina, and all over the world. Militarism, white supremacy. Capitalism, in its naked and unchecked form that we see it in today. Unclean spirits that must be named and driven from our collective body in order for us to be healed and set free. Now again, this might all sound a little heavy, a little bombastic, so I'm gonna flip the script and focus on the positive. Well, these encounters that Mark describes, they're cinematographic. It's like a movie. It's so dramatic. It's so conflicted. It's even violent seeming, the way these bodies convulse before they're set free. But the end result is healing and transformation. The end result is healing and transformation. Even as Jesus toils every day amidst the immiseration the suffering of the poor, because that's who he's bringing his healing to. People who are really suffering in misery. He spends a huge amount of time describing the kingdom of God. The kingdom of God is like this. The kingdom of God is like that. Huge discourses throughout the Bible of what the healing and transformation, the promise of God, looks and feels like. In the face of such powerful forces at work in our world today, we both have to believe in and envision a different set of values, a different set of rules, a different form of living together, structuring our world so that we can live in justice and harmony, in love and in peace. In a similar way, whenever we find ourselves mired in the depths of our own captivity, whether personal or collective, and sometimes we do feel like we're being held captive in a very real way, can't get out, right? We have to, no matter, even if you feel like there's no way out, no light at the end of the tunnel, you have to spend some time imagining what it would be like to actually be free. You have to imagine your own liberation, your own freedom, your own healing, your own grace. At the end of the interfaith panel we had on Israel and Palestine last week, we spent a considerable amount of time looking with open eyes on the atrocities that are unfolding across the Holy Land. But at the end, I asked both panelists, the imam and the rabbi, to envision what justice would look like, a justice that leads us to peace. In a similar way, I want you to take some time and be honest with yourself about any ways that you might be struggling, that you, whether because of sickness or relationships or whatever it might be, either now or in the past, have felt mired in the depths of your own captivity. And I want you to take a moment and envision your healing. Imagine your restoration. Believe in your reconciliation with yourself and with God. What would that look like? Who would be there? What would it feel like? What would it smell like? What would it taste like? Your healing and your restoration. And I want you to envision that for this church, for your communities, for our nation, for this world. And I want you to remember and believe that healing, that healing, that restoration, that liberation, that love, that peace, that reconciliation, that Jesus is working that change in you, not only in you, but in this neighborhood, this block, this community, and this nation, and across the world. With that healing and that liberation is the promise, the good news of Jesus. Amen.
And so many reasons to give God thanks and praise. Let's take a moment to give back to our church community and the world. You can give by placing your offering in the plate or by sending it to the check to the church by check, or you online to the financial secretary by Zelle. As we have been so richly blessed, let us seek to be a blessing to others. Your morning offering will now be received. For giving us these gifts to share, our time, talents, labor, and treasures. Consecrate them and us as well, so that we may become a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable to you. Amen.
I believe, Loretta, you wanted to say a couple of words, is that right? Please, you can stand up and Stephanie will bring you a microphone.
Some of you may know, or you may not know, that Clinton, my husband, died recently. And I wanted to come today and express my family's and my appreciation for how you have supported us. It was like a crowd of angels from heaven surrounded us. You prayed for us. You came to visit. You brought us food. You sent beautiful cards and letters expressing love and concern. And we're so grateful for all that loving support that you gave us. This year was very hard. Clint was hospitalized on different occasions. He spent time in rehab, weeks. And during that time he gradually continued to decline. And our pastors, Mike and Michael, were faithful to visit him, whether at hospital or at home. And in one of the readings today, there's this sentence that says, love binds us together. Your loving support really helped us hold us together and give us strength. And we thank you so much for that. It is true, totally true, that love does bind us together, that we are one in God. And John, it's so true what John says in 1 Corinthians 8, chapter 13, 8. Love never fails. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Loretta, for those kind words. And let us all pray for Loretta. Loving God, we give you thanks for the life of Clint, whom we have commended to your loving care. We ask God that you continue to bless and uplift Loretta in whatever trials and tribulations and celebrations she endures at this time or is undergoing at this time and in the future. God, we give thanks for this congregation, this crowd of angels that has gathered so faithfully around Loretta and Clint, and gathered so faithfully around one another in times of need. For all this, O God, we give you thanks, for great is your faithfulness. Amen.
Amen.
What other prayers do you have to lift up to God at this time? Stephanie.
Good morning. You heard our son Stone ask for prayers for his friend Ethan. We did not give our children this update this morning, but we learned that young Ethan, who was 4.5 years old, passed away overnight. He had an undiagnosed rare neurological condition that set on very quickly in the last 2 weeks, resulting in seizures and tremors and swelling in his brain. We asked for prayers for his parents, who are our dear friends, and his older sister, who is six. We just can't even imagine them leaving the hospital today without him. And, you know, it's going to be a long road of acceptance, understanding, and peace seeking for them. So please keep them in your prayers. Their names are Melissa, Jack, and Clara.
I can't think of any. I can think of a few things more traumatic and more shocking, particularly as a parent myself, to know than that is happening. I'm so sorry that has happened. There are no words to describe it, or even no words that could console. We pray for Melissa. What were the other two names?
Jack and Clara.
And I mentioned this to Stephanie in a message, but sometimes in these moments, we remember that Paul says that the Holy Spirit intercedes for us with sighs or with groaning too deep for words. And so we know that God also cries out when these things happen, when these tragedies occur. And so we just will be there. We'll be there for you, and we'll be there for them if there's anything that we as a congregation can do. God, in your mercy. Yes, Carol.
I want to thank the choir for the beautiful music this morning.
God, in your mercy. Anybody on Zoom or Facebook Live? Loving God, we come before you commending all those for whom we have prayed, the names we have lifted both out loud in our and that remain on our hearts but have not been spoken on our lips. Amen. And now let us pray as Jesus taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Do we have any first-time visitors with us this morning? Seeing none, I'm going to ask that you read the announcements in the bulletin. Read the announcements that are in the bulletin. And I'm not going to read them all. If anyone feels the burning need to speak one aloud at this time, now is your time, because I do want to make room for our congregational meeting that is coming immediately. Yes, Chris.
Statements for 2023 were sent by email. If there are any discrepancies, if you didn't receive it, please let me know and I will fix it and get it back to you.
Any other burning announcements? Yes, Becky.
It's burning. No. I brought two friends with me last week. They were visitors. They'd never been here before. They came because they knew I was attending a new church and they were curious. And I just want to say that they loved this place. And they really, the word I think they used, it was such a welcoming, warm ambience when they walked in, the way everyone greeted them. So I wanted you to know that, because I think you need to know, you need to get feedback that this is the way people respond to you. And I really appreciate it. And that's the reason I'm here. It, among other reasons, but getting that kind of warm welcome really makes a huge difference.
Thank you so much, Becky. And I hope everybody takes that to heart, because this place is all those things that they described. Thank you for sharing that, Becky. Let us rise in body and spirit as we are comfortable. We're going to ask, this is a hymn that I don't believe has been done here, but it is a hymn that is popular primarily in the Black church. It's a wonderful hymn. I picked it specifically for our congregational meeting afterward, because we're asking Jesus to lead us, to guide us, not just as individuals, but as a church. So everybody rise in body and spirit as you're comfortable. The choir is going to sing the first verse and the chorus, and then we're going to all start in from the top, singing the refrain and then the verses, right?
The choir is going to do as he said. We're going to do the refrain and the first verse, then you join us when the refrain comes back around. Okay?
Each day.
Go forth from here today, seek your healing, believe in your liberation, for it is your promise, it is promised to you through the good news of Jesus. Love one another as God has loved you, and love yourself as God has loved you. And the Prince of Peace, the God of peace, which passes all understanding, will guard your hearts and minds in Christ Jesus. Let us go in peace, but first let us stay here for the congregational meeting. Amen.